We're starting a monster truck rally. Oh, I just looked over there in Sandra's eyes. I said, monster truck. She went, glory to God. I'm glad to see some of you folks made it back.
Amen.
The weather hasn't detoured you, and that's good. A few announcements. We'll get them quickly out of the way. We have prayer and Bible study starting at 5:30 on Wednesday. So come out and be with us for prayer and Bible study. And then Saturday, we have a sectional ladies meeting here. Sister Peggy Snyder is going to be preaching. And I just talked to her pastor, in fact, from Stockton area. And it looks like him and his wife will be here as well, just visiting and backing some of their people. And so we should have quite a few turnout. So come out and be with us, having lunch afterwards, I believe. And then, of course, Sunday, we have Shamgar and Jessa. And we're going to have a potluck, but you need to tell my wife what you're bringing. We're going to have hamburgers and hot dogs, so talk to my wife. And we're oh, Brother RJ, Brother RJ. Tell you, Brother RJ must have ate his oats this morning or something, because he's thinking sharp and quick tonight. Yeah, I told him as he walked in, I told him, father-in-law, I told RJ, I said, I didn't know you guys had a fireplace. He said, what do you mean? I said, I heard you've been cutting logs all day afternoon. And he got a little rest this afternoon. Maybe we're all in trouble tonight, amen? Let my wife know what she's going to bring. We're going to be doing hamburgers and hot dogs, so we'll get that all taken care of. And just going to make it easy on us next Sunday. Amen. We can have a time of fellowshipping with the evangelists and get to know them. And I think, I'm not sure on the age, but I think they're somewhere in their mid-20s, this evangelist and his wife. So they're a young couple. They just got married not too long ago, but he can preach. So we want to be here for that. Amen. So we'll have services like normal, 10:30 and 5 o'clock next Sunday, and looking forward to that service. Amen? And so with that all being said, I think we have just a whole bunch of stuff coming up, but it's not this week, so we'll keep you informed on that. And just a lot of things that God's getting ready to do. We got Friday Night Praise in February. We've got the end of this month. We've got a youth rally in Turlock. And we also got a youth rally in Merced. So, local ladies meeting on the 28th at 10 o'clock. And then the rally is that night at 5. So, a lot of stuff going on that day. But that's a local ladies meeting for you ladies to start. Are you going to start that book? Start of the new book, Redeemed. So come out and get involved, ladies. Make plans to be here. Amen? And then, so we just got a few things coming up real quick, and January seems to be kind of a little bit of a slower month, but end of January on through the rest of the year, it's going to be fast and a lot of stuff going on, so get a hold of it. One thing I do want to encourage you, in April, we have Ethiopian missionaries, and their names tend to escape me right now because it's strange. Oh, Rebecca's back here. Looks like she's got a brain freeze right now because she knows the names too, and we can't think of them. It's a weird name. But anyway, here's what we're going to do. We're not having them go church to church for itinerary. What they wanted to do was get them in to where several pastors can hear them at one time. So the 28th of April, we're going to be having that Friday night praise, and they're going to be the ministers. And it's entitled A Night of Miracles, because this man and his wife move in miracles and things of that nature. That's their ministry and things of like that. So they're going to be here with us. I'm not sure where it's going to be yet, but we are going to have that on the April 28th. So I know it's a few months down the road, but set your calendar so you don't book something else, because you need to be at that service. Amen? So we're going to have it'll be our Friday night praise, so we're going to have a lot of churches there. I wish I could remember his name, Per something. And if you think I'm crazy, I'm not. It's Per something. No, it's not far. It's real close. But Anyway, so we'll be going to have that, but I just want to kind of give that kind of a heads up so you kind of get that set up in your mind. Anyway, other than that, we're here for one thing tonight, amen? That's to praise and worship God, amen? And, oh, Per Akvist. That is their name, Per Akvist. I don't know if it's the first and last or if it's just the last name. But Per Akvist is what their name is. And so, great, our missionary, our district missionary leader, which is Brother Augie Rodriguez, is, he contacted me and asked if we could set something up, and I said, sure. So we're going to have them with us for that time. Anyway, with all that being said, let's stand. We're going to pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we know this is a Sunday night, Lord. And Lord, we know, Lord, that we come in here and we're wanting to worship and praise you tonight, Lord. Lord, we ask, Lord, that we'd set our minds in the right frame, Lord. Put our minds upon you. Put our hearts and our souls in the right place, Lord. And Lord, everything we do, bring glory and honor to you. Lord, we thank you and we praise you, Lord Jesus. Let us take our time and worship and praise you, Lord, and just move in your time in this place. In Jesus' wonderful name, amen. Ask the praise and worship team to come, and we're going to enter into praise and worship.
Is everybody ready to worship the Lord? I'm going to tell you, I think the keyboard's fixed. but I did, and it was actually throwing me off, and I was trying to adjust the way I do the sustain pedal as well, and it was bothering me. It was really interrupting the flow of things, and it was really just irritating me. So I'm glad that it's working. I know it just needs to be reset, but you know, Satan really tried to mess with the service this morning, didn't he? There was just disruption after disruption, and you know, my husband come and told me what was happening, and I knew in that instant that he was going to be bothered for the rest of the service. But you know what? We're not going to give Satan victory. We're going to give the Lord victory, because God still moved in the service this morning. His anointing was still here. His power was still here, and it's here again tonight. Amen? So tonight, we're just going to worship the Lord and just give him some honor. Amen? You got your instruments ready? Not poof, you're a piano. You got your instruments ready? Yes, all right. Can you believe what the Lord has done in me?
Can you believe what the Lord has done in me?
Well, he saved me, cleansed me, turned my life around, and set my feet up on a solid ground.
Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Life around and set my feet up on a solid ground. Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Well, he saved me, cleansed me, turned my life around and set my feet up on a solid ground. What the Lord has done in me? Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Well, he saved me, cleansed me, turned my life around, and set my feet upon the solid ground. Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? What the Lord has done in me? Well, he saved me, cleansed me, turn my life around, set my feet upon the solid ground. Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Well, he saved me, cleansed me, turned my life around, and set my feet upon a solid ground. Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Can you believe what the Lord has done in me? Well, he saved me, cleansed me, turned my life around, set my feet upon the solid ground. Can you believe what the Lord has done in me?
Amen.
Well, I am blessed. I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed, I am blessed. Well, I am blessed, I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed, I am blessed. Well, I am blessed, I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed, I am blessed. Well, I am blessed, I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed, I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed, I am blessed.
One more time.
I am blessed, I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in morning till I lay my head to rest. I am blessed. I am blessed.
Amen. If you're blessed tonight, let's just give God some glory. Let's praise Him. We are blessed. We are a blessed people. Amen.
I will. wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy. Awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Oh, King of Kings, you are my everything, and I will adore you. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe. I just want you.
Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you.
I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. And I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart.
I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you. I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that I just want you. And I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you. And I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you.
Oh, says I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. It's a hard thing for humans to understand that just sitting at the feet of Jesus makes everything better, makes everything new, makes everything. Goes on to say, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything. Do you realize he doesn't owe you anything? And do you realize you can't earn any more of his love than what you've already got? You say, well, that is not right. Yeah, said he loves you no matter what you are. He loves you in spite of yourself. He cast his love towards you. And while you was yet sinners, Christ died for you. That means, you know, we as humans, we tend to earn things from people. We don't have to earn it from God. God gave it to us. All we have to do is say, God, forgive me and come into my life. And he loves me just as much as he loves Sister Becky, just as much, the same love, the same amount. Amen. Glory to God. You know, that's where Jehovah's Witness, you know, they got to work their way to heaven. We don't have to work our way to heaven. Yes, we're charged with a great commission. Yes, we're charged to witness to people. We're charged to see souls saved. That's not working your way to heaven. That's just doing what your Father asks. His love is going to be the same. Amen? Glory to God. Love that song, don't you? Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise and worship team, thank you. You may be seated. Glory to God. Well, I guess I kicked you out of here a little soon, unless somebody can play the piano for me. She needs you to play. You can do it. We got us a special tonight. Where's your microphone, Mom? There's two types of people that I like to honor. And that's those that do what God asks them to do and those that are willing to do what God asks them to do. Amen? Last night, so just kind of give you a little bit while my wife's getting the piano. Last night, Dad was sitting in his chair, and he was insistent that he sings. He loves to sing. And so when I got down there last night, he was sitting on the edge of the bed singing House of Gold. What key, Mom? We used to sing it in C. We'll try that. Does he have a microphone nearby him? He's on a green mic. Turn that mic up a little bit, please, because he's going to need some help. And he's going to sing House of Gold. And most everybody knows that song. You can join in with him when he sings it, but he's going to sing House of Gold. You going to sing for us tonight, Dad? You going to sing for us tonight? You can do it from right there. I don't even make you get up. How's that? All right, let's sing this song.
In a deep, dark grave, I know my head. I know to say, there's a difference. Of gold behind my God and lose my soul. Some people need and buy less than what it will buy. So we're saved.
Hallelujah. 85 years old and still sing a song and carry a tune. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Glory to God. I pray that I can still carry a tune when I'm 60 years old. Well, she is, I'm glad she loves him. Hallelujah. I'm going to give you three of you a chance to stand and testify. Real quick. Come on, we don't want to waste a lot of time here. Go ahead, hon. Yes.
So thankful. But it doesn't matter if we have a house full or if we have a half a house, or if it's just me and myself and I, we're going to worship the Lord.
Yes, amen. Amen. Glory. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody stand and testify. Come on, Brother RJ.
Yep.
Somebody. Praise God.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
Yes, yes, glory to God. Somebody else, Brother Carter. Yes, amen. Yes, amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you something. I don't know how long this message is going to go tonight, honestly. But I'm going to tell you, I'm going to preach what God gave me. And I need you to pay close attention. As Bishop says, you'll listen quick, I'll preach quick. You listen slow, I'll preach slow. So everybody's going to listen quick, right? Listen fast. Amen. What happened was a few weeks back, there was a message preached in another passage in Samuel, and I jumped over to 1 Samuel, and we're going to be in 1 Samuel chapter 5. But I jumped over there, and I began to read, and God began to show me something that is very necessary in the church today. And so as I sat down this afternoon and began to study, I put some notes down, but as we was going through praise and worship, I'm asking God, God, is this what you want? And I don't know if I'm going to stick to my notes, to be honest with you, or not. I would just preach where God, it's only five verses is all I'm preaching on tonight. Six, if I throw that extra one in there, but that's going to be six verses total. But and anybody knows pastor knows he can go for an hour and a half on six verses if they're really good ones, amen? And so, but tonight I want to talk to you on quit worshiping the stump. Quit worshiping the stump. And I want to show you something. In 1 Samuel, and I'm going to back up just a little bit, so let's don't get into Scripture yet, but 1 Samuel chapter 5 is where we're going to be. But if you back up before that, it talks about Eli. And it talks about Eli's sons. And it talks about when the Philistines came upon Eli's son and they killed the sons. And then they went and the sergeant of arms basically got escaped, and he got over there and he got to Eli, and Eli was sitting there, and Eli was old in his days and couldn't see. His eyes were dim, could not see. And he began to talk to me, and Eli said, "What of my sons?" And he said, "They're both dead." And it said Eli fell backwards and hit his head and broke his neck and died. Now, if you don't know the story of Eli, Eli was a great in the house of God. They would have sex with women at the doors of the house of God. They would allow this. And Samuel had already went to Eli and said, "This is what God said," and God and Eli ignored and didn't want to face his family. He chose family over God. Let me tell you something, and this ain't part of my message, but if you're choosing family over God, you're going to end up in hell. You got to choose God first, and then family will fall into order. Amen? So Eli comes to this point, and he dies, and then the daughter. Now, all this was happening because of the ark of God being moved. And the ark of God was moved one more time. And the daughter-in-law was pregnant with child. Because the ark of God was removed by the Philistines from them, the presence of God left. she, in her birth of giving birth to a child, died. So we've lost Eli's sons, which were no good. What would Brother Spink? Sorry dogs. They were sorry dogs. So was Eli at this point by now, because he wouldn't do what was right. The wife of one of the sorry dogs that was killed, she died and left a son. And so they come to all this, and then it comes to the point to where the Philistines have the Ark of God, the very presence of God. That's what it resembles, is the very presence of God. And in chapter 5, in verse 1, it says this, "And the Philistines took the Ark of God and brought it from Ebenezer unto Ashdod." Now, Ashdod is an area, okay? We got this, right? Too many people today are trying to take the presence of God for granted. They think it'll always be there. God said, "One day I will remove my presence from this earth." That's like these people that say, "Well, you know, I'll wait till everything happens and I'll just cry out to God at the last minute." If the presence of God is gone, the conviction won't be there. And you won't cry out to God. Now, I'm getting somewhere, so hang with me, okay? And this may be a short message, but I'm going to get somewhere. And if you'll hang on to it, you understand what I'm saying, and you'll see where our wrongs are and where our rights got to be. Amen?
Amen.
We've tended to put God up on a shelf and use him like a genie and just pull him down and rub him when we get in trouble. That's not what the presence of God is for. The presence of God is for you and I to live in. The presence of God is for you and I to dwell in. So here the Philistines had taken the presence of God, and they take it to Ashdod. "When the Philistines took the Ark of God, they brought it unto the house of Dagon and set it by Dagon." What is Dagon? Dagon was one of their little gods, the little G's. It was the one they worshipped. And so they brought the Ark of God and put it by Dagon. Oh, let's just stack the big God up by all of our little gods. Let's stack the living God up against the dead God. Let's stack that God in our sins. Instead of us getting out of our sins and getting into God, we'll bring God into our sins. That's not what the Word of God says. Today, too many Christians are trying to bring God into their mess instead of trying to get into God and leave their mess behind. A lot of us get wound up with friends and family and people we know and people we meet, and we get too entwined with them to let God be God in our lives. Let me tell you something. It don't matter how bad you think life is. The fact of the matter is God can take care of it and straighten it out for you. You say, "Well, I keep hearing that, but I don't see it." You know what? I can get you person after person after person to give a testimony to prove to you that God can do it. But the difference is you've got to want God to do it. Goes on to verse 3. And when they of Ashdod arose early on the morrow, behold, Dagon was fallen upon his face to the earth before the ark of the Lord, and they took Dagon and set him back in his place. Listen to this. They come in to their room, and their God is sitting there. And so they bring the presence of God, and they put it there. And they leave. And they come back. And Dagon is on his face before God. What does that symbolize? Even the false gods will worship at God's feet. They don't have the power that he's got. They come in there and they look, and here's Dagon laying there, but the power of God, the presence of God, is still sitting in its place. It's still in the holy place. Even in that room, it's still in the holy place, in the center of the temple, where it belonged. But yet Dagon was laying on the ground. But yet they was looking at that going, "Oh my goodness, our God has fallen." So what'd they do? They went and they picked him back up. And they put him back in place. Oh, I just love the picture this paints. Says verse 4. Well, let's back up to verse 3 for a second. A lot of us today are trying to put our gods back in the place and trying to make God live with our little gods. Let me tell you something. Isaiah 42 and 8 says this. They got it up there? Yes. "I am the Lord, That is my name. And my glory will I not give to another, comma, neither my praise to graven images. Let me tell you something. I don't know if you've ever read that scripture or really caught that scripture, but read it the way it's written. It says, I am the Lord. 2 points. Then it goes on, that is my name. Can you hear God speaking to you tonight, saying, I am God, that is my name, and you will pay attention. I will not share my glory with any other, and I will not share my glory with graven images. Let me tell you something, church. It is time the church gets out of the graven image business and gets back into the living God business. It's time we get back to the place where we know that that is God's name, and this is His place and not ours. I read that, and I got so excited because when... Just think how forceful that is. When it goes, that is my name. God wasn't messing around. He didn't want you to be mistaken by who He is. He says, I am the Lord, and that is my name. You know what He was saying? Can I put it in what I feel He's saying here? I am the Lord, that is my name. You will not disgrace my name. You will not take my name in vain. You will not act a fool in my name. You will not be an idiot in my name. You say, oh, pastor, did he say that? Hey, let me tell you something. God will keep you from being an idiot if you let Him. You will not worship the wrong thing in my name and call it God. I am the Lord, and that is my name. Oh, when I read that, I leaped inside because I thought, there, that's the God that I serve. The God that doesn't mix words, it tells you straight up. That's my name. Never forget one time we was in a grocery store. I got in trouble for this. I got big trouble for this. And something was done. I don't even know what was done. But my dad was there. And I said, yep, that's Jim being cheap. I didn't get in trouble for saying being cheap. I got in trouble for calling him by his first name. Because that's his name. But to me, his name is Dad. That's Dad. Now, that wasn't lately. That was way back when I was a kid and stupid, or not as smart as I am today. At least I didn't say stupider. Anyway. And he informed me, Dad is my name. And that's how you will address me, is Dad. Let me tell you something. It's time that we begin to understand the Lord is His name. And that's how we will address Him, is Lord. Not man upstairs, not the other guy, not the one that helps me, not the one that blesses me, but we call Him Lord. And Lord of Lords is who He is. That is His name, Lord. So all these crazy Philistines, being a dumb idiot they are, get back over to my scripture. They went in there, they found Dagon down, they put him back in his place. And when they arose early on the morrow morning, behold, Dagon was fallen upon his face again to the ground before the ark of the Lord. And the head of Dagon and both the palms of his hands were cut off, or as the Jewish Bible says, severed. They were cut off or severed. Were cut off upon the threshold, only the stump of Dagon was left for him. In the middle of the night, the presence of the Lord came up and grabbed that little Buddha issue and picked him up, ripped his head off, took his hands off, laid him at the threshold, put the stump down, and left it. Now, significance. The presence of the Lord showed that that man, that little statue, had no mind and it had no power. Because he took the hands off and the head off and left a stump. Let me tell you what I do with a stump. I use it to chop wood on. I don't worship it. I don't bow down at it. I take it, I'll put another log on it, and I'll swing an axe and hit as hard as it. And if it notches that stump, I don't care. Because that ain't my God. But a lot of people today in churches are worshiping stumps in their life because they're not wanting to get them out of there. They're not wanting to clean house. They're not wanting to throw the trash out and let God come in and be in the place he wants to be and he needs to be. You say, oh, I got God in my life. Is he in the center of your life or is he in the side room? Is he in the center of your life or is he along the shelf with all the other gods that you got? The gods of TV, the gods of whether it be alcohol or whether it be smoking or whether it be cussing or the gods of filthy lucre or whatever the god is he there as a god or is he there as one of the gods? I don't know about you, but only idiots worship stumps. Listened to a comedian the other day. I let my wife listen to it too. And he was saying, how many members David Koresh? Yeah. He said, you know, he tried to be Jesus. He says, I knew he was a phony from the get-go. He said, because my God wouldn't have glaucoma. Wouldn't need to wear glasses. The guy wore glasses. He says, I can see Jesus come back to get his children and say, come on, hold on, I got to stop by the mall and go to Lens Crafters and get my one-hour glasses. He said, no. He said, you know what Jesus would have done with? Healed. Okay. But people are stupid enough to believe and worship stumps like David Koresh.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
We can go back a little further. What was his name? Jim Jones. People worshiped him.
Yeah.
There's people that's died because they've worshiped stumps instead of knowing who God is.
Yeah.
Not on my watch will you not know who God is. You will know who God is as long as I'm standing because Isaiah 42:8 says, I am the Lord and that is my name.
Yes,
and he said they went in there and the presence of God was still sitting where it belonged. But Dagon was face down, face broke, hands broke, and all that was left was a stump.
Yeah.
Whew. Sister Becky tells me that I can be replaced by a butt that doesn't work. That's fine. I'm not going to worship no stump though. There's only one true God.
Yeah.
The Philistines thought it was a great idea to try to put him in with their gods.
Yeah.
Here's the interesting part. Eli and his sons were blessed as long as the presence of God was there. Once the Philistines took the presence of God, thinking that they could win the war,
yeah.
Oh, they beat Eli and the sons because of the sin that was in their life, and they died. The daughter-in-law died, but they thought they could take that and put it in to their stuff, and they would be powerful.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to tell you something. I'm not going to preach in this area, but I'll tell you the rest of the story. The rest of the story says that we got to get rid of this thing.
Yeah.
This thing ain't no good for us.
Yeah.
And you know what? You know what they said? They said, well, we need to make a new cart.
Yeah.
That's what they said. We need to make a new cart, and we're going to put it on an animal that's never given birth before. And we're going to set that animal off, and we're going to walk away and let it wander until it finds its place. A couple things, and I'll just share them real quick with you. Never once was the cart made, or was the presence of God made to be on a cart.
Right.
Learned that. Stuck with it. Boy, that was preached to us by Brother Gaetano the other day at the men's meeting, how the presence of God had gold rings on it for the men of God to carry, the priest.
Yeah.
But the Philistines, they got rid of it that way. But that's something, if you want to look at that, read on into 1 Samuel some more, into 2 Samuel chapter 6, and you'll find some great passages there, and your mind will be blown. But let's back up to what the Philistines are doing here. What would you have thought if you came in, and here's your God, Dagon, dummy. And you know that nobody was in that room all night.
Right.
But you come in there. First thing you see is him laying on the ground. So you think, okay, well, he must have fallen. You know, pick him up, you put him back. The next day you come in there and his head's removed and his hands removed and put at the threshold. Now, I kept looking at this, the threshold, the threshold, the threshold. What does this mean? What does this mean? And I looked around and I couldn't find it. But I begin to think in my mind, the threshold. You know what Dagon was trying to do? Get out of the presence of God. His hands were at the threshold saying, I'm out of here, Jack. I know that I don't want anything to do with this nonsense. And that was what the sign that he was trying to give to the Philistines is, you better get away from the presence of God. That's the presence of God telling them, you better run just like your false god did. because he turned him into a stump. Now listen, I'm almost done. You say, boy, you didn't preach very long. Well, I preached long this morning, so I want to make it short tonight so it evened out to be about the same. Only a stump of Dagon was left to him. Therefore, neither the priest of Dagon nor any that come into Dagon's house tread on the threshold of Dagon in Ashdod until this day. I looked at that and I said, Lord, what does that mean? He says, we need to have people quit showing respect to their little god.
Yeah.
To this day, as far as I know, they will not step on that threshold when they come in because Dagon's hands are laying there and his head's laying there. Yeah. So they step around it because they want to show reverence. Let me tell you something. You got a bunch of idiots showing reverence to a statue, but we ain't got people that can show reverence to God in church.
Preach.
Shame on us. The God that spun this whole thing into being. The God that takes the whole world and puts it in the palm of his hand. And we can't show him reverence, but we got people in the church that are showing God's in their lives reverence every time they get up and go have to buy us a pack of cigarettes and smoke one.
Yeah.
Every time they got to get on Facebook and start attacking somebody.
Yeah.
I tell you, I've heard so many messages here lately about just that, the social media, people attacking each other on social media, and I'm going to tell you what one pastor said, being a coward. You got some little emoji, you don't even say where you live or who you are, and you're out there bad-mouthing, just banging on people all over the place.
Yeah.
You know, I believe social media is a great tool for the church. I really do. But I also believe it's a great weapon for the church. And we got to be careful. My wife today, I opened my social media. I opened up Facebook, and there was somebody on there, and I don't know what that is. And I clicked it, and there was a whole bunch of names and then some inappropriate pictures. I hollered at my wife. I said, hey. And she looked at it. I said, do not respond to this person. I don't want to be tagged in anything. So we went through and found the removed tags and removed it and blocked this person. I don't even know where it came from. It just out of the blue shows up. And I told her, I said, her and Rebecca, I said, go check my Facebook and make sure there's nothing inappropriate that's been placed on there. So what are you saying, Pastor? That's what Satan's doing, trying to defeat the child of God.
Yeah.
See, I'm going to tell you something, but God's bigger than that.
Yeah.
And we've been worshiping, there's been people in the church worshiping stumps way too long.
Yeah.
Never will forget Brother Boyd. Came into our church and we was going to do something. I forget where he's moving now, but he says, well, Pastor, is that one of those sacred cows? How many knows there's sacred cows in church? There's things that you just don't do in the church because somebody's going to get mad. One of the things we did that irritated people was we took the remembrance table out. It's a piece of furniture. It's in the way. I'm sorry. I just don't like the remembrance table. Never have. Never will. It's in the way. We put this little table up there. It don't have to say in remembrance for me because there's nothing on there to do in remembrance of God. If you, in remembrance of God, come to church.
Amen.
Be in his house on Sunday. Come and visit.
Amen.
My parents, I go down and visit with them. Why? Because I want to remember them. I want to remember them. I want to have good times. I want to have good thoughts and good memories of them. That's how you get to in the remembrance of. You come to church and be in the presence of God.
Yeah, amen.
But a lot of people in churches worship stumps.
Yeah.
Worship the sacred cows.
Yeah.
Oh, when we first took our songbooks out of this church, oh dear Lord, the second coming of Christ couldn't be quick enough. Songbooks? We had to have songbooks. We got to hold them in our hands so we could sing. Lord, now if I brought songbooks in here, most of you people wouldn't know what to do with them. Praise God. We had to buy chairs with songbook holders. I have no idea why. Sister Becky said she's going to stand on them, make her look taller. You know, the neat part about that was that set up, and I didn't even have to say it and just had to repeat what she said. It's great. She knows exactly. I told her this morning, I said, you got to put your thinking cap on. You know what she told me? I got my other wig in the other room. Anyway, remember, what you say to me will be using a message. We give respect to that stump that is due to God. Church, I'm here to tell you tonight, if you've got a stump in your life that you're worshiping, you need to get it out of there. Only good stumps, the only thing stumps good for besides chopping wood on is burning.
Yeah.
And you got, you know what, I'm gonna close. I was digging a leech line in our front yard the other day. Had a, not by hand, don't know you people looking at me like, I'm acting crazy. I had an excavator, I'm digging. And there's this old stump that we had taken out 7 years ago. We had this tree taken out and left the stump. And I turned around, I looked at that stump, and I spun around the excavator. It was just a small excavator. I thought, I bet you it won't take it out, but I'll give it a shot. I hit that thing, and it was rotten.
Yeah, there you go.
I popped that thing out in three pieces and hauled it out the back, got rid of that stump. It's been giving me a problem for 7 years.
Yeah. Wow.
You say, what's that got to do? Listen, a stump will rot.
Yeah.
God will not.
Amen.
Maybe I should put that on a shirt. The stump will rot, God will not. And then put this scripture, maybe they'll catch it at some point. Somebody will go home and read a Bible. We've been here 7 years.
Wow.
Let me tell you something. When you're worshiping, when you're worshiping the stump, you will get into a place where it will be no good for you.
Yeah.
But when you worship God,
yes,
when you set your eyes upon God,
yes,
when you don't veer to the right or to the left, but you set your eyes upon God and you run for the race that was given before us,
yes,
and you worship Him above all things. I'm going to tell you something. I know it's easy to get hung up in worshiping something else. It's easy. For 2 years, I got hung up in worshiping a job where I was making good money, and I was traveling, and I was having all this fun. But the fact of the matter is, God took that away from me because I had to quit worshiping it, Brother RJ.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong. I believe we got to make a living for our family. But I do know this. God will also help you and bless you to make that living. And you don't have to worship what you're doing. You can worship Him first, and He'll bless the rest. Amen. Glory to God. We've got to quit worshiping the stump. Amen.
Yes, amen.
I told you I wasn't going to preach long. You listen fast. I preach fast. Amen.
Amen.
You know what? I'm going to read that one scripture just over again just because I like it. Isaiah 42:8. I am the Lord. That is my name. And my glory will I not give to another, neither my praise to graven images.
Yeah.
Mm. He didn't mix words.
Nope.
So let me just put it to you this way. I read that scripture. He said He won't share His glory with anyone. So if you're allowing that to happen in your life, you're sinning. A sin is a sin.
Yeah.
There's no little white sin and little black sin. They're all sin.
Yeah.
A sin from stealing a penny is the same from stealing $1 million.
Yeah.
It's a sin.
Yeah.
It'll send you to hell.
Yeah.
And I would hate for you to stand before the pearly gates and stand there and look at St. Peter, and St. Peter said, well, you worshipped this. And you just say, nobody ever told me that was wrong. I'm telling you today it's wrong.
Yeah.
If your mind and your heart is not worshiping God 100%, 110%, then you're sinning because you're worshiping something else. Because man is made to worship.
Yeah.
Something.
Yeah.
You either worship God or you worship Satan. You say, oh, I'm not a Satan worshiper. Check what you're worshiping.
Yeah.
Check what you're worshiping. But you know what I found? When I worship God, all heaviness flees.
Yes, amen.
And I get caught up in His presence.
Yeah.
He don't have to do anything.
Amen.
All I want to do is sit at His feet.
Amen.
That's all I want to do.
Yeah.
I thought about, as I said that, I thought about what Sister Pauline Gilbert said. Brother Spinks, she said as a young man, Brother Spinks would come over to her grandparents' house, the Barnes' house, good people. And she said one of the first regulations she didn't have, I think it was about, she was about 6 or 7, something like that. And here Brother Spinks would come in as a young minister, and he was sitting at the feet of Brother Barnes, listening to the wisdom being poured into him. And I thought about that. I thought about how it would be if we sat every day at the feet of God. If we sat at His feet and said, God, I'm not here for a blessing. I'm just here to listen. I'm just here to worship. I'm just here to magnify. I'm just here to honor. When we get to that point, Brother RJ, that's when God will open up the windows of heaven.
Yes, amen.
But we've got to get to the point of worshiping God and not worshiping the stump.
Yeah.
Too many pastors get to worship in the stump, which is a number in a church. I'm not going to worship a number in a church. I'm going to worship God. Let Him take care of the number. How's that sound? Amen.
Amen.
Let's stand across this congregation. Very simple message. Quit worshiping the stump. You know, every one of you people, when you drive by and see a stump somewhere, you're going to remember this message. I pray you do. I pray you do, because it'll bring back to your mind who you're supposed to be worshiping. I'm going to ask us to come to the altar and just pray for a little while, worship God for a little while, spend a little time with Him. So if there's something in your life you're worshiping, get it kicked out and let God come into that place. Let's come to the altar.